Series. I'm Douglas MacLeod, the chair of the RAIC Center for Architecture at Athabasca University, and I wanted to wish some people a good morning, some people a good afternoon, and some people a good evening. Now, I'm disappointed to tell you that we didn't get the grant we applied for the Global Studio, but nonetheless, there's been such an outpouring of enthusiasm for these activities that we're going to continue nonetheless. Now, it'll be a bit reduced, but so many people volunteered to help that we'd be foolish not to. And I want to point out, we have a whole group of people who have volunteered, professionals from across Canada, who volunteered to work with Veronica in order to develop a mentoring network. And we're hoping that this mentoring network of volunteers could be expanded around the globe. Certainly, we were approached by the RISE people in Lesotho who were asking for something similar to this. So if you're a practicing professional and you'd like to help, we'd like to hear from you. At the same time, we do still have a little bit of funds left, and we're going to try and spend these, however, on student-led activities. So if there's students out there who would like to work with other students in other parts of the globe, we would be very interested to hear from you. And with that, I'm going to jump into the lecture. And today, I am going to be speaking about the architecture of hope. Now, what led me to start thinking about this was this picture. I was in Toronto for a conference a couple of years ago, and it was in May. And every tree in Toronto was in bloom. But when I looked out my hotel room into this alleyway, I saw these two, and it puzzled me because I couldn't understand what was going on. That's the Toronto Dominion Centre in the background, and it is one of the icons of modern architecture in Canada. And when I looked at this little courtyard, and you can see there's somebody actually smoking down in one corner, there's construction going on, and it's an alleyway with trucks and things going by and back and forth. I thought, what's going on here? And then all of a sudden, the courtyard flooded with little people, with children. And I realized it was the playground for the daycare center in the Toronto Dominion building. Now, the TD center, it's got lobbies that are clad in Carrara marble. It's got a plaza that's clad in rose-colored granite. And I thought to myself, in this sea of opulence, is this really the best that we can do for what I'm going to argue is our most precious resource, our children? And I was been chewing on that idea for a number of months when I was approached by Woodlake Publishing, which is a small publishing company right here in Lake Country where I live in the Okanagan Valley. And they said they were looking for people from different disciplines to write on a variety of different virtues. And so I knew what I wanted to do. I wanted to write about the architecture of hope. Now, I didn't want to write a dry kind of essay, though. I wanted to do something a little bit different and try and describe something. Now, one of my professors when I was at the University of Toronto was online, Terry Montgomery, and when we were there, we were introduced to the work of Ray Lifshay from the University of Berkeley. And he suggested that his students write scenarios about describing how people would use their designs. This is a really effective technique, both for the student and for the faculty who's reviewing it, because I'm going to suggest to you that you can Photoshop in as many people as you want into your renderings, but until you've actually tried to put yourself in the mind of, say, a single parent with three children who's trying to get from the parking lot to the lobby of your building, I'm going to say that you don't really understand your building yet. So scenarios are a really effective tool for talking about architecture. At the same time, I was introduced more recently to the work of Trevor Haldenby. Now, Trevor Haldenby does what's called science fiction prototyping. And that's a very interesting technique for trying to figure out what the future might be like. And what he's done is he's created this whole series of little videos about a fake company called Biologic that has all of these weird products. And it's actually very, very funny. It's all on YouTube. But it's a great way to think about a better future. And of course, in Canada, we have to do everything with a hockey analogy. So what we have is a quote from Wayne Gretzky. So you're supposed to skate to where the puck is going, not where it's been. And that's a really important idea, because we tend as architects and planners to still be skating where the puck has been. And we need to think about the future. We need to think about how we're going to build buildings in the future. So we need to tell a new kind of story about architecture, one that can act as a scaffold for hope. So when I talk about the architecture of hope, I don't say that architecture can give us hope, but it can be a scaffolding for building a new kind of approach to the environment. An architecture which can help us regenerate our environment, our economy, our society, and even ourselves. So I wanted to tell a story about what a community could be like in 2035, about 15 years from now, if we really started to do things differently. Now, I'm not going to tell you the story, but rather today I'm going to talk about the facts and the ideas and the concepts behind the book and how we might be able to do things better. So in the idea of cleaning up your own backyard first, I've set it in the Okanagan Valley, which is where I live. It's not on the west coast of Canada, but it's about a 4 or 5 hour drive from Vancouver and the Pacific coast. So this is what the site looks like that I've speculated. Now, nobody needs to be worried that any of this will all ever be built. This is completely fiction. It's just to describe how things might work. So you can see this site though is kind of interesting in the respect that it's been logged of all of its trees. This happened quite some time ago, and it's currently pasture land. This is what it looks like in October. I live in a place called Lake Country, and you can see the lakes in the background. When we have a new dean in the Faculty of Science and Technology, and in her signature line, she has this wonderful quote that experiencing the self is separate from nature is the foundation of humanity's damaged relationship to planetary resources. So I had to check this quote out and find the article. It's a very good article. And it even suggests that people who have had positive exposure to nature are much more likely to act in an environmentally sound manner. So it is a very interesting site. It's quite a dramatic one as well. And this is what the view from the site looks like. So you can see down in the valley, it's a very lush environment. But at the same time, there is a problem. And this is how one of the characters in the book expresses it, that our communities are overpriced, poisonous, overcrowded, unhealthy, wasteful energy peaks. And that's kind of a dramatic statement, of course, but let's unpack it to see if it's actually true. Now, this is information taken from the US Green Building Council about what buildings do. And as you can see, if you wanted to do one thing to combat climate change, it would be to start making better buildings. This is an extraordinary amount of bad things that are being done by buildings today. And we need to start changing that. But I have to give a caveat here in about almost every slide you're going to see. The science is still very inexact. I was doing a piece for Canadian Architect a couple of years ago on climate change, and I checked and I went and I talked to all sorts of sources, and I got information ranging from 17% to 33% about how much greenhouse gases are emitted by buildings in Canada. That's a pretty big spread. Part of the problem is we don't have as good an idea about how buildings behave. We don't have the best information about building performance, and that's something that's got to change. But I do encourage anybody who's listening to not accept anything at face value, but rather dig yourself and find the information and even share it. So, but nonetheless, it is a significant chunk. I would estimate that buildings in Canada emit 25% of our greenhouse gases when all is said and done. So, as these people said, building energy efficiency is not low-hanging fruit. It's rather the fruit that's lying on the ground rotting. And as a profession, as architects, as designers, as planners, this is something we absolutely have to address. Now, the other part of this is I'm claiming that our buildings now are functioning as what I call brown boxes. They take in all sorts of wonderful things, and basically they become a machine for spitting out garbage. And not only garbage, but we pay through the nose for this privilege. I'm now paying about $500 a month Canadian in terms of utilities for all of the things that I have to do in this house. And that's almost like carrying a second mortgage. A lot of this is unnecessary, I feel. Now, the other thing, though, that we have to think about is the building materials that we use. Now, the Living Futures Institute has created this list of chemicals which are used in common building products which are not good for human beings. And this is called the Red List, and it's kind of scary. In fact, looking at just one of those items, formaldehyde, you can see all of these things that we are surrounded by right now are held together with formaldehyde. Formaldehyde, I think everybody probably knows, is not a pleasant material, not a pleasant chemical, and is carcinogenic. But if you are inside someplace, it's very likely that you are sitting or touching or surrounded by formaldehyde. So this is kind of a scary situation. At the same time, it seems to be such a peculiar thing that if we really could cut energy use in buildings by 20 to 30% without any changes in technology, you want to go, well, why the hell haven't we? And to understand that, we actually have to look at what architecture means. Now, we started this series off, Odile Dex spoke about architectural thinking. And I'm going to claim that architecture is the most important discipline in the 21st century because it's the only one that has enough of an interdisciplinary influence to really address the problems of our times. And it's fascinating to me. I did a lot of research on the architecture of cyberspace, and the pioneers of the internet talk again and again about the architecture of the internet. And what they mean is not the wires and the switches, but rather the concepts behind the internet. And in this sense, everything has an architecture. Every complex system that humans make has an architecture. And of course, though, when they spoke about an architecture, they were very vague about the definition. So I said to myself, as an academic, I abhor a vacuum, so I've got to develop a working model of what an architecture is. Now, the purpose of any model is to make it as simple as possible, but still be able to mimic the thing that you're trying to model. So in that respect, I developed four dimensions for what an architecture is. These include the available technologies, the policy framework within which it operates, the value system, and of course, the design principles. Now, you'll immediately say, well, there's lots of things missing from this. In particular, where are the socio-cultural factors? And that's really critically important, but I'm going to argue that the socio-cultural factors are actually embedded in each of these dimensions of an architecture. You might also say, well, where's the environment? But for good or bad, these things actually define our response to the environment. At the same time, it's not quite right, because anybody who's worked on a building knows that this is not a well-oiled machine in which all the parts and pieces move smoothly together. It's more like this, where everything grinds against each other, where all of a sudden you've got to cut $3 million from your building and it's going to compromise your design principles. Or you found a wonderful new technology, but it isn't approved by the building code. So we have this kind of conflict that's happening. But moreover, each of these dimensions exists in a spectrum. And so, for example, when we look at our value system, Dan Ariely, in his wonderful book, Predictably Irrational, points out that we exist in two different economies, one of market exchange, which is the one where we give money for this, that, and the other thing, but also one of social exchange. And that's our relationships with our family and our friends. Now, social exchange is non-monetary, but it's also reciprocal. If you and I are friends and I do something for you, but you never do anything for me, that's probably going to fall apart. And he gives this wonderful example of how to test this theory. If you go to a restaurant for a meal, you of course are expected to pay for it. But if you go to your in-laws' house for a meal and you offer them some money for the meal at the end of that meal, you might not even be invited back. So we do live in these two different worlds, and it's important to understand that the social exchange one is equally important to the market exchange one. And in fact, all of these dimensions exist on this spectrum from open to closed. And one of the ones that we'll be talking about is capital in service to labor and labor in service to capital. But when we think about that, you can see if labor is in service to capital and you're a corporation, it makes perfect sense to move your factory to where the labor is cheapest. Now, if capital is in service to labor, then the people who are working in the community will not want to move their factory because that means the loss of their livelihood. Now, what I saw with cyberspace was that it started out at this end where everything was open. Open source was very important. Everything was, basically anything was permitted, and there was lots of social exchange happening online. But over time, as more players get involved, it shifted in this direction. So armed with this idea, we can start to look at the architecture of architecture. And this is a rather problematic one at this phase. We have kind of a weird policy environment. Everything's kind of getting out of whack. And so we have this situation in which we have almost irrelevant design principles, which are highly stylistic, but perhaps aren't addressing the real problems in the world. We seem to misunderstand technology or use antiquated technologies. We seem to have a stunted policy environment, but a lot of this is actually driven by our value system. Now, some people say we live in a knowledge economy, others say we live in a service economy, but we don't. We live in a shareholder economy where short-term profits trump long-term benefits every time. And that's really important to understand. Imagine you're the CEO of a Fortune 500 company and you stand up at your next annual general meeting and you say, we're going to cut dividends significantly this quarter in order to do the right thing and get all the toxic chemicals out of our products. Well, you probably won't be the CEO at the end of that AGM. So it's really important to understand basically where the money goes. And we can start to see that. What's happened in Canada is very interesting. Over the years, we've actually flattened our top tax rates from 70% to 33%. That's in the last sort of 40 years. Our corporate taxes have been reduced from about 38% in 1986 to 15% in 2012. Moreover, we've now developed a very strong lobbying industry, which is worth about $300 million in Canada. It's about $3.4 billion in the United States. So, because of all these things, we can't actually afford to build and repair the infrastructure we need. And moreover, I have watched every significant plan to reduce greenhouse gas emissions be destroyed, derailed, or diluted by powerful lobby groups. And if you'd want to learn more about this, Naomi Klein's book, This Changes Everything, lays it out in depressing detail. So in this situation, though, one of the solutions that has been proposed is to go with, let the private sector build our infrastructure. And at first glance, that seems like a wonderful idea. Unfortunately, in the studies that have been done, and in my province of British Columbia, this study was produced about 2 years ago, we're going to pay an additional $3.7 billion because we went for private-public partnerships on these 17 different projects rather than the traditional procurement problem. Our process. And so you can see we've made a kind of difficult situation for ourselves. Now, at the same time, I was walking in the woods behind my house a couple of years ago, and all of a sudden this started to happen. They were building a new subdivision, and an excavator came in, and it was just knocking down trees. Now, that tree in the center of the screen, that's a jack pine, and it's probably about 200 years old. And in a matter of moments, it was just walloped and gone. And this is why I say that the wrong people are building the wrong infrastructure for the wrong reasons. And this is why we should be worried. But there is hope. We have started to develop ideas about regenerative design, and I wanted to thank my colleagues, Trevor Butler, Veronica Madonna, and Henry Tsang, because over time we started to build up a list of what we could do if we did things differently. But I also want to do a shout out to the Supernatural Design Collective, which is started out of Dalhousie University, because they as well, quite on their own, have decided that this is a critical issue of architecture and we need to address it. Now I'm going to talk about some of these principles, but basically, as one of the characters says in the book, the big idea is that we could restore rather than destroy. We could produce rather than consume, and we could purify rather than pollute. Not just the earth, but our bodies and minds as well. And that's kind of critically important. So if we think about this, we can start to see cooperative value systems, human-centric technologies, policies for people, and I would argue other creatures, and regenerative design allow us to move forward with a new approach to architecture. So in the first principle, the idea of restoring more of the natural environment than the development occupies, this is a very interesting site in the sense that it's got these kind of benches. In fact, a lot of this land is called the benchlands because it has these natural terraces. And you can see, again, some of those terraces. But the other thing I want to point out is that lushness in the valley is all because of irrigation. And irrigation uses 70%, it's an estimate that 70% of the world's fresh water is used for crop irrigation. And often it's used very, very badly. In other words, one of the things that happens when you drive down through this valley is that you see these major, major sprinkler spray systems out in the fields, and they're shooting water out into the air to cover the field. Well, sadly, some people have said that 40% of that water is evaporated before it actually hits the ground. So we're wasting water. A better approach is to look at what the ground itself is doing and to see that we've already got these swales and these corridors. In fact, this is a very lively environment. It looks like parched grass, but when you go up there, all of a sudden you're hearing the hawks, you're hearing the blackbirds, you're being pelted by all sorts of insects. You can see the marks that the deer and the coyote have left all through the fields. And there is every kind of really interesting plant life going on. So the concept is, could we make an environment in which we're starting to work with these natural swales, these natural creeks, but enhance them because they're not retaining the water. And you can do a lot of that by just planting the right trees. Now, this is a wonderful site by Diana Beresford Kroger, Call of the Forest. And it actually has this little tree app that tells you, for whatever region that you're in, what are the best trees? What are the native trees to your area? Sadly, it's only for North America at the moment, but it is a very helpful resource to when you want to replant an area. One of the things, though, that I wanted to do was wrap this whole site in aspen trees, and we'll talk why that about that later, but also to add in a food forest because we want to have this food self-sufficiency. Moreover, could we start to develop new kinds of pathways through the environment? This is a wildlife bridge, which I quite like. We have others like this in Canada, but the idea of building bridges across the swales for not just the humans, but for the animals as well. And with that in mind, though, we can start to, well, what I was literally trying to do here was paint the site with houses. And I work in Adobe Illustrator a lot, and you can actually make custom brushes. So I made a custom brush with the houses and the property, and just started basically painting until I had 500 houses and with lots of space in between them. And this is one of the more contentious ideas I want to talk to you about, because density is something that we often accept as needing to make higher and higher and higher. And often we say that higher density is more sustainable, but there is a price to pay. And I want to talk a little bit about this. I was going to entitle this talk, Everything You Need to Know About Architecture You Can Learn from Rats in a Cage. But the fact of the matter is, we've seen some stunning experiments. Now, back in the 50s, when they were first starting to study addiction, they would put rats in this little cage and they'd give them a bottle with ordinary water and a bottle that was laced with morphine. Not surprisingly, many of the mice became addicted to morphine. But somebody, Bruce Alexander at a Simon Fraser University, said, what if the problem is the cage? So he made Rat Park. This is Rat Park. It's supposed to be an enriched environment for rats. And in the enriched environment, the majority of the rats weren't interested in the morphine-laced water. Some still became addicted, but most of them weren't. Now, he also studied people who had come back from the Vietnam War who had been heroin addicts. And he found that many of them, when they got out of the war zone, were able to kick their habits. This is very important. It suggests that the environment is a major stressor, or can be a major stressor, in terms of addiction. At the same time, others actually found enriched environments led to the growth of new brain cells in mice. Now, earlier on in the last century, it was thought that neurogenesis, or new brain cells, stopped when you became an adult. But apparently, in the right environments, in the right stimulation, it can continue all through your life. So this is a very positive effect that the environment can have. This one, though, I'm sorry to say, is extremely scary. And this is from the 50s. John Calhoun started making these mice environments where the mice had all of the amenities you could want, all of the stimulation you could want, but he just let them breed. And at a certain point, the population turned in on itself, no matter what he did. And what would happen is you would actually get gangs of criminal mice who engage in rape and cannibalism, and others who just became couch potatoes and just took no longer interest in anything, even including reproduction. And his conclusion was that there can be no escape from behavioral consequences of population density. Now, we don't like to hear this because we like to think that by putting more people in the space, of course, the infrastructure is much smaller, but we have to think about the negative consequences of this. And it's not just in mice, because other researchers found when they were looking at college residences, they looked at a low, medium, and high density residence, and they found the greatest sense of community and generosity was always in the low density environments. We have to think about space as a very essential human requirement. But there's other ways of looking at things, which I think are kind of more interesting in terms of the structures. And this is what I wanted to share with you.
The internet doesn't really cost you anything. It's just a connection. So however you can get plugged in, then you're on the internet. Nobody owns the internet. There's no one to pay.
So that's a very interesting opportunity of mesh networks. But I really like what he said. Nobody owns the internet. And yet, I'm going to say it belongs to us all. Similarly, nobody owns the sun, the wind, the water, or any of the Earth's resources, yet they belong to us all. And I think we sometimes need to reclaim our basic right to the abundance of the Earth. And mesh networks offer us an opportunity to do that in a localized and decentralized manner, as I'll explain in a second. But I couldn't talk about mesh networks without talking about mycorrhizal networks. Now, this is extraordinary. It's like somebody said, it's like a city that lives under your feet. And we didn't even know about this internet of fungus until the 1990s when a researcher, Dr. Susan Simard at the University of British Columbia, noticed something very peculiar in the forest. In a forest, you might have Douglas fir trees and you might have paper birch. Now, the Douglas fir is considered to be valuable because it's softwood and can be harvested and sold. The paper birch is considered to be like a weed because it's not so valuable as wood. So what they like to do is come in and rip out the paper birch. But interestingly enough, when they did that, the Douglas fir saplings died. And Dr. Simard wanted to figure out why. And she uncovered this whole network that connects all of the trees. And in actual fact, the paper birch were sharing nutrients with the Douglas fir. So this is an incredible cooperative sharing network that not only shares nutrients, but also complex sugars, water, and even information. So if one tree is attacked by aphids, for example, it'll send out a warning to all of the others. This is an extraordinary example of a mesh network that's been working for millions and millions of years. On the other hand, the way we do things now, recently in Kelowna where I live, they 2 years ago, they announced that there was going to be a $63 million plan to clean water for 2,000 houses. This seems like a little bit weird because I knew about these things. This is from a company that was out of Oakville, Ontario, that was once in Canada. I think it's gone to Hungary now. But you can get this box, and it's about 6 feet high and about 12 feet long, and it can clean the water of 1,200 households per day. Now, this isn't a fair comparison with the 63 million, because the 63 million include reservoirs, water lines, pressure-reducing stations, and water meters. But I heard the inventor of the xenon boxes, Andrew Benedict, speak on the CBC radio. He just won the Lu Kuan Yew Water Prize from Singapore in 2008. And he said, we have to think about infrastructure differently. It's like computers, he said. We used to have mainframe computers and batch processing where you would submit a job to these technicians. They would run it on the mainframe and you would get it back a couple of days later. But now we have computers and even, of course, smartphones that are more powerful than those mainframes. And they live in our desks and in our pockets. And that's what we need to do with our infrastructure as well. So we can create a localized, decentralized micro-utility for water using these kinds of xenon filters that works with the natural environment so that it's all part of a system. And micro-utilities is actually not a new idea. In fact, when telephones were rolled out, many of the telephone corporations didn't want to serve the rural areas, so the municipalities themselves had to do it. And they would create their own telephone exchanges. And this continued on. As a matter of fact, in Alberta, the government in 1906 set up Alberta government telephones, which provided service to the province right up until 1990 when it became TELUS, which is a major telco today in Canada. So there is lots of precedence for micro utilities, even nano utilities. And you can see that if we can get them to work in a mesh network, then things are going to be very, very different. A similar revolution is actually happening in batteries. Now, when I wrote the book, I was looking at a price of perhaps $150 per kilowatt hour for storage by 2025. But we're blowing by that already. And by 2023, they're saying you could store this for $100 per kilowatt hour. Now, the average household use is about 30 kilowatt hours per day in North America. That's an awful lot. But at the same time, one of these batteries could serve and do a day's worth of storage for up to 30 houses or more. And that's important because if we're using renewables, we have to have a reliable way of storing it. So we can think of then batteries distributed across the landscape that are working with the houses themselves. And now I'd like to talk a little bit about food and food forests and vertical farms. It is extraordinary what we could do doing. I speculate on what we might be able to create in terms of vertical farms for this environment that include not just the hydroponics for the growing the plants, but also integrated with aquaponics, where you can be growing various kinds of seafood and that are interacting basically and being supported by the crops that are being grown as well. And the impact is incredible. This again is the site and it's pasture land. So it has a certain, you can estimate its caloric output. But if you were growing crops, you could get the same caloric output from a much less little blue rectangle as you see there. And if you move to vertical farms, you're using 200 times less water and 20 times greater crop yield, and you're reducing the transportation distances by a factor of 40. So as you can see here, if you have a vertical farm, it only takes that amount of space. And what I was speculating was that if you made four-story vertical farms, just about that scale, you could have as much food output as from this entire pasture land now. So there's a lot of lessons that we can learn from this. And this is one of them. This is kind of sad, but also hopeful, because we can't rely on our politicians and business leaders to solve our problems anymore. But we don't need to, because the way things have evolved in terms of decentralization and localization, we have all the means at hand to solve these things ourselves. But another thing which is very clear to me, and this is an extraordinary bird's nest I found up on the site, so integrated with the tree that it's in and that it's almost invisible. And we've got to start thinking of our sites as communities themselves, because they are, and we have to work in partnership with them. And moreover, we need to stop differentiating between the built and the natural environment. Now to do that, we need to start thinking a little bit differently about technology too. I'm always ambiguous about technology. I've worked with it all my life, but I always see as well some of the concerns that we have. But Mies van der Rohe said this like some time ago. And what's so interesting about it is that both the meaning of technology and architecture have changed or are changing. So when he said this, you could still think of buildings, the construction site, as a critical laboratory for technology. And in truth, architecture has given us arches and vaults and domes and all elevators and air conditioning and all sorts of incredible technologies. We don't think of it as high tech because shortly after Mies said this, we started to think of technology in digital terms. And that's really changed the way we see technology. But even as I said, architecture is changing as well to be much more comprehensive and interdisciplinary in terms of its meaning. But I want to show you a couple of examples of what I mean by this. This is where mud brick transcends into earthen architecture. This is the beautiful madrasa in Timbuktu. And it's actually kind of a living building because a lot of those wooden pieces are there to help replaster the structure with mud on a regular basis. Similarly, we can see red cedar transcending to the magnificent architecture of the Northwest Coast, where these houses are actually living entities with their own names and reputations, and they even transcend their physical components, because a house may be rebuilt and repaired many, many times, but it never loses its essence. And that's a really different way of thinking about buildings. Similarly, when Medili spoke 2 or 3 weeks ago, the designers that she's working with are taking old and new technologies and helping them transcend into a new architecture for Africa. I also think that Philip Beasley's work with the Living Architecture Systems Group, where he's using sensors and Arduinos and other kind of rapidly prototyped components, is transcending into what may well be the future of architecture. But at the same time, I found this beautiful little illustration, and it's almost 600 years old, and it's of building sites in medieval times. But if you go out to any subdivision in North America, you can see much the same situation today. The same trades using the same tools, and note, they're still almost exclusively guys. Only 5% of tradespeople in Canada are women. So in home construction, we have a lot to make up. And that's why I say we've got to get human-centric technologies that transcend into an integrated architecture of regeneration. And I wanted to just sort of sketch out what some of those things could be. Now, as I said, using existing technologies, we can do quite a lot. For those of you who don't know, our values are a measure of insulation. So typically a wall may be R13 to 23, but the passive house, which is a new approach to building buildings, the walls may be R40 to R60, the roofs may be R50 to R90, and they're trying to avoid having furnaces and air conditioning just by higher insulation. But of course, there's other things you can add in as well. Wind turbines, photovoltaics. I'm thinking here that we could run all of the services in the roofscape and connect all of the houses together in this one kind of what we call in Canada utilidor with all of the things inside it. I want to focus on just a couple of technologies that I thought were particularly attractive though. One is the Warka Tower. Warka is the name of a giant fig tree in Ethiopia. It's created by this group Architecture and Vision and Arturo Vittori. And what it does is it harvests water from fog and the dew. And you can see sort of the dimensions here. And it's really, really simple. There's no engines or computers or anything involved. And it can harvest up to 100 liters of clean water per day. So now, granted that the average Canadian house uses 522 liters of water today, it's not going to solve all of our water problems, but it shows how we can start to approach some of these problems in a natural manner. Similarly, my colleague Trevor Butler is building earth tubes right here in Kelowna on a regular basis. And by burying these things down where the temperature is relatively constant, you can get cooler air in the summer and hotter air in the winter, and you can reduce your energy consumption by up to 70%. I've actually seen these in operation, and it's quite magnificent, and they're so simple. The only technology really involved is a little fan to blow the air into the furnace system. So, but more important than that though, is how do we integrate these things? How do we start getting all of these energy sources working together? How do we start getting all of these water sources working together? And then how do we get these two things working in concert? And what I'm going to suggest is that we can take this diagram now and reverse it. So instead of outputs become inputs is what I'm saying. So we can actually take garbage in and turn it into useful things, whether it's energy or materials. We can also harvest the sun, the wind, the geothermal, the rain, the snow, the fog, and the dew. And then we can be outputting, hopefully, more energy than we consume, more food than we can produce. We can be producing clean air, clean and fresh water, and even generating materials from some of the waste. So this is a complete reversal of the way that we think about buildings. And my hope is that we would actually be generating money for the inhabitants as well. But there's more to it than that. We have to think about the quality of our life, the spiritual quality of our life as well. This is an amazing structure at University of British Columbia. It's actually just a ventilation shaft for a parking garage. But Sarah Hall, who's this brilliant glass artist, integrated photovoltaics with stained glass to make what I think is a very, very beautiful structure. And we see examples of this again and again, leaf-shaped solar panels, new materials like aerogel, which has a value, an R value of 20 per inch. Fiberglass is about 3.5. So this is, and it's incredibly lightweight and fire resistant. This is an actual photograph. I've seen another one, I couldn't use it though, where somebody had their face on the aerogel and the flame was right underneath them. It seemed a little intense. Similarly, nanocrystalline cellulose, it's made from plant fibers. It's an antioxidant, so it's actually good for you, and it's incredibly strong, and it can be used, it can change colors. Flexible graphene solar panels, we're looking at a revolution in terms of materials. Somebody's even figured out a way to basically take grass clippings, because of course plants are natural photovoltaic cells, paint those grass clippings onto a membrane, and generate solar energy. Not a lot, mind you, but it's very interesting that we could integrate organic material and make it into solar panels. And this is the kind of walls we may be able to create with a nanocrystalline shell, because it's incredibly strong, an aerogel interior, which if the walls were 40 centimeters would have an R value of 300, which is insane. Remember, the passive house is going to 50 for 60. This would be about five times bigger. We could then wrap it in flexible graphene organic photovoltaics. Moreover, we could embed sensors in these walls so we could really learn about how a building behaves and collect this data and share it to really do some intense research. Now, as soon as I say gathering the data, you should all be afraid, because any data that is gathered is subject to being hacked. So we need to think about how we protect our communities, not just from natural disasters, but also from data-based disasters, I would say. And we're looking at new forms of encryption, which would be part of the community and an essential part. And the concept here, though, is walls working with rooms, working with homes, working with neighborhoods, working with cities, working with countries, in a seamless mesh of shared and healthy, sustainable resources for everybody. And when we start to mix and match all of these things together, we can imagine new kinds of walls and roofs integrated with new kinds of energy generation factors. And moreover, though, I couldn't help doing this because I'm very interested in projection mapping. And the idea of being able to change, you know, nanocrystalline cellulose has this ability to actually change color. The idea of making every house and home into a consolidated art piece was just too good to miss. So this is all very fine, though, but unless we address this other factor of regeneration about creating income, we really haven't done our job. And one of the primary examples I found and I wanted to share with you is what happened when this Roman Catholic priest, Father Arzamendi, came to this Basque town in 1941. Now, Spain had just finished a horrible civil war. The Basque town was in total destruction, disarray, and he needed to figure out what could he possibly do to help the people. And he said, we need an educational institution, a factory, and a financial institution. So they made a technical institute, they made a factory for making kerosene, and they founded a credit union. And more than that, though, and this is really important, they came up with 10 principles for how this corporation called Mondragon, after the town, was going to work. I've talked about capital as an instrument of labor, but it's really impressive what they've been able to do. This is still a company that's worldwide, 75,000 people, revenues of 12 billion euros, but this is important. The maximum pay ratio at Mondragon is 1-9. In other words, the highest paid employee only makes 9 times more than the lowest paid employee. But if you go to the Fortune 100, then the ratio is 1-129. In other words, the highest paid, the CEO, may make 129 times more than the lowest paid employee. This is one of the reasons why we have such difficulty in terms of the inequity of income in the world. And this is something Mondragon has addressed. I suggest that this is something we should almost adopt as policy. So what would happen now if we were able to do something different? Well, I'm suggesting for this site, we have the opportunity to tap into both deep geothermal and maker spaces to actually make houses. And we have the ability to create online universities like Athabasca, which is actually sadly thriving in during this period of COVID-19. I want to talk about financing though in a minute. So this is deep geothermal. They're now developing this Everloop, goes down. It acts like a radiator and it picks up the heat from the earth and brings it back up and drives turbines to generate electricity. In the Okanagan, we are very fortunate to be a hotspot. So we would only have to drill down about 1 kilometer in order to get that kind of heat and therefore that kind of energy source. This though is not unusual. All over the earth, there are these hotspots. Iceland is the best and they run everything off of deep geothermal now. But one of the other approaches though, and this gives you an idea of what could be generated. This was one where they're drilling for sedimentary aquifers. These are hot, basically hot saltwater aquifers deep in the earth. And if you do those, you can get a 5-20 megawatt power plant, which can power 5,000 households. So that's pretty incredible. Notice though, that's oil rigging, that's oil rig drilling equipment. And in fact, we could repurpose the entire oil and gas industry to drill for deep geothermal because the depths are similar and the equipment is the same. And in fact, the Canada Geothermal Agency has identified about 500 existing wells that have the potential to do exactly this in terms of sedimentary aquifers. So the real question is why we aren't doing this right now. Now, I also want to talk a bit about 3D printing, and I have this little video. The fact that they were able to build this in the middle of winter in Russia is kind of interesting. But at this point, most 3D printed houses are really just squirting concrete. But it was done in 24 hours. I think they mean just the walls there were done in 24 hours. And it has quite an interesting price tag. So we are facing a revolution, but I'm going to tell you, I think this is just the first stage in the 3D printing revolution. If you want to see what the future could be, Mark Furness's work, like this one, the Boolean operator, which he built in China, it's all 3D printed, but this shows what the possibilities are. So in that sense, back to the site, if we want to generate income, we have the power stations, we have the maker space. But at the same time, we need to adopt a different approach to technology. So for example, this is Madeline Gennell. She's called the robot whisperer. She actually has a master's degree in architecture and she teaches robots how to move. And I love this idea because I really do think that ordinary people need to own their own artificial intelligence and their own robotics. And that architects and planners need to become community whisperers where we understand this technology to the point where we can diagnose it and work with it. Now, if you'd like to know more about this, my colleague Veev Kumar and I, who's on Views Online, we wrote a scenario for what learning might be like in 2050. And we were speculating that everybody in Canada would have their own artificial intelligence assigned to them when they got into the school system, and that the two, the human and the AI, would grow together. And that's the idea that unless we own artificial intelligences and robotics, I can guarantee that all of us will lose our jobs, if not in the next decade, in the next 2 decades. Because again, if labor is in service to capital, there's no reason not to move to AIs and put everybody out of work. But if we own the artificial intelligence, if we own the robotics, as I'm suggesting we would in the community like this, then we all profit from it. And moreover, we have meaningful work because we're working together with these technologies rather than against them. And that's, again, capital being in service to labor. So I did want to address this in the last few moments of what I'm doing, because this is really critically important. You've got to follow the money. I want to explain to people what the CMHC is. It's the Canada Mortgage and Housing Corporation. And I didn't really understand it, what it did at first. I thought it gave mortgages to people who had lower incomes. It doesn't. The banks don't want to give mortgages to people who have lower incomes. So they don't want to take a risk. And so Canada set up this thing called the CMHC, which sells mortgage insurance to people who have lower incomes. And Canadians, being the wonderfully hardworking people that they are, every year, well, last year, they put in $2 billion in terms of premiums. And yes, the CMHC does build some housing, but they also generate a profit, that net income down there, of almost $1.6 billion last year. And I think, great, $1.6 billion, that'll build a lot of houses. Well, no, because that money is now grabbed and put back into the general coffers of the government. So I claim in every instance, we are surrounded by abundance, including an abundance of money. We just have to learn to access it properly. And for an even better example, there was a group of women who were living on the streets in Kenya, in Nairobi in Kenya, who started to pool their money. And they formed the Jamibora Trust, and they were able to give microloans to people to start businesses. And then they accumulated enough wealth to actually form their own town, the Kapute New Town. And this is a wonderful model for us all to learn from. Another one, though, is this, the Preston model, or sometimes called the Cleveland model. And basically, it's so simple, you'll just be stunned. Basically, what they said is, well, why don't we get our anchor institutions, the universities and the hospitals in Cleveland and Preston, why don't we get them to commit to the idea of only sourcing their labor and their supplies from local businesses? And if you do that, it regenerates the entire community, because all of a sudden, people have jobs. When there's jobs, there's wealth being generated. It leads to more wealth. It leads to more revigoration of the entire economy. And it's such a beautifully simple model. You've really got to wonder why we aren't doing it in every city and community across the country. So this adds in the final piece. The school is the anchor institution in the community of hope. And of course, it's got the super node that shares the mesh network of information for the internet with the entire community. Now, I think we could do more, though. If we learn from the Wood Wide Web, we can start to connect all the parts and pieces that we've talked about in a very interesting kind of mesh network. And I returned to the work of John Calhoun, who did those mice utopias that were so horrible. He actually said his later universes were designed to be spiritually as well as physically utopic, with rodent interactions carefully controlled to maximize happiness. I don't know about maximizing happiness, but the idea that there should be a spiritual component to our communities is critically important. So we can imagine that a community then becomes a mesh network of plants and fungus and animals, combining human and non-human intelligences, all working together. And that's the concept that we could have an integrated, localized, and decentralized infrastructure. And here's a really simple example. We can now use drones and things for all sorts of things, but the batteries in electric vehicles can move energy between locations in a mobile electrical grid. This is called vehicle to grid. And we start to see that our transportation system could be integrated with our energy system. So you might actually find a drone roosting on your roof, sucking up energy to recharge its own batteries. The final thing I want to talk about is forest fires, because although I think I live in a place which is very close to being paradise, we have forest fires. This one was very near to my house a couple of years ago. In fact, the evacuation line was just along my back fence. It was sadly started deliberately, but it just swept up the hillside and destroyed all sorts of houses like this one. Now, this gets back to the aspen trees. This is a sort of slides from a video which shows they set a controlled fire to burn through first a whole grove of fir trees, and then it hits the aspen trees and it stopped dead. And that's a remarkable thing. You think, okay, we do this, we wrap our communities in aspen trees. But here's the kicker. the BC government, the British Columbia government, which is forward thinking in many ways, actually has a program to go out and poison the aspen trees with a chemical much like Roundup. And the reason is the aspen trees, again, are not valuable wood. They're not softwood, and they interfere with the other trees, the softwood trees, although perhaps not given what we know about mesh networks now. So they're poisoning all of these things. And we need to think differently. And what I'm saying is, because we are surrounded sometimes by stupidity, and because we now have the means to do things locally in a decentralized manner, we have to give ourselves the responsibility and the authority to do so. And we know what's right, and we now know the means to do it. This, I think, is very hopeful. And that's why I say, when architecture reaches its real fulfillment, it will transcend into hope. So before we go to the questions, I do want to plug our next lecture. This is going to be on, I believe it's, let me just check my calendar, Tuesday, November the 3rd, again at 9 a.m. Mountain Time. And Kristen Kornienko and a team that's been working in South Africa are going to present their movie called Solidary, revealing the everyday lived reality of COVID-19 in Cliptown, Soweto. I'm hoping that you'll be able to join us for that one as well, and of course, register in the same place. And I wanted to finally just thank some people. I really wanted to thank Woodlake Publishing because they've been very kind in letting me write this in the way that I wanted to write it, but also Veronica Madonna and Henry Tsang and Carol Mason and Laura Mahadden, who do such wonderful work in helping us put on these lectures and getting people their continuing education certificates. So they really, none of this is in their job descriptions, but it is a wonderful thing. And I'd also like to thank everybody who came today. And with that, I am happy to open it up to questions.
Great. So I'll just navigate the questions for you, Douglas. If anyone has questions, please feel free to type it into the chat box. The first question comes from Darcy, and they're asking to confirm, in a shareholder economy, is it up to us to model these those doing things on their own rather than advocating for change in flawed policy and value systems put in place for decades? How does the architecture of hope address the problematic systems which continue to thrive and strengthen?
Yeah, and that's more or less the last part of what I was talking about. I believe we have to form cooperative workforces that can do things differently, because it's what we've seen is it's almost impossible to change the political system we have now. So we simply have to sort of separate ourselves from some aspects of it, form cooperatives that can actually do things in a responsible manner, and with the hope that it will, by setting a good example, by doing things in a localized and decentralized manner, we can start to create better examples for how people could work. The hope is, of course, is that others would form cooperatives as they did in Preston and in Cleveland, and that this would be more of a movement that would be in stark contrast to the way that we do things now.
So this is a comment, not so much a question. This one is from Gary, and he writes, as a young Greenhorn architect, I worked on a housing scheme in Durban North. We surveyed all the existing trees and designed the complex and open spaces around them to preserve them in design. And the first thing the contractor did was move on site and flatten all the trees.
Yeah. It's a kind of a brutal world that we live in. But, you know, here in the Okanagan, we've actually had discussions whether Lake Okanagan itself could become its own legal entity. And the reason for doing that is that it could then have rights and couldn't be, for example, damaged in the same way that we're doing these things to trees. So it's almost as if the land itself has to have the same rights as some other legal entities. And it is tragic to me to watch how we just bulldoze trees without even thinking. I know sometimes we can't keep every tree. It's too bad. But when you think about the mesh networks, when you think about the ways that the trees interact, we've got to have a better policy for maintaining the natural landscape and for regenerating it too.
Yeah, absolutely. So there's another comment here that I'd like to read from Trevor Jacobs. So he's writing, complex theory and systems thinking is covered in sustainable development education in South Africa. Some of the principles of sustainable development should be incorporated into architectural education or all disciplines for that matter.
You know, that's a very good point. And we're very fortunate at Athabasca to have Trevor Butler be part of our team. And Trevor's convinced me that the first sketch that you should make when you're designing a building is your sustainability diagram. Too often what we do is we wait till the end of the project and then we slap solar panels on the roof or put a wind turbine here or there. We've got to start doing that earlier in the process because, as Trevor has shared with us, integrating the systems and learning how they operate together is really, really critical, and it will have an impact on the design. Whether it's, I mean, Trevor, I won't speak for him, but you know, he advocates, first you look at the passive systems. How can we use the sun? How can we use the wind? How can we use just natural insulation to create a building which doesn't have to have all that much mechanical heating and cooling? Then add in the active systems of photovoltaics and turbines and other things that can put you over the top. And it's important to recognize that, again, we're on the cusp of a revolution in renewable energy. As photovoltaics are getting cheaper and cheaper and more efficient, we're almost at that cusp where they will absolutely be the cheapest way of generating energy. And of course, there's a huge abundance of solar power. The one, of course, critical aspect that we need is effective battery storage. And as you've seen, this is coming along too. And so the trajectories are coming together in a manner which suggests that very soon we'll be able to have a very different picture of how energy works in buildings. And we have to be ready for that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a really important point in that, you know, there's so much we can do by just looking at design in a very holistic and smart way and using things that in our environment that can help us, solar, wind. And then if we start from there, then we can implement in with other systems. So the next question comes from Daniel Price. Has there been any studies in how this model can be reproduced worldwide with current population densities?
Yeah, well, I think that's part of the issue. Do we have to form, in some instances, in order to get less dense cities, do we have to form new communities, as they did in Kenya, that are kind of outside the city, in order to make, in the particular instance of Kapute, they actually found not only did they finally have their own land, but they also had a safer and healthier environment for everyone. So I'm not saying we abandon cities, obviously that would be stupid, but we need to think differently, particularly right now, because all of a sudden, so many people are working out of their homes because of COVID-19. And it, of course, the density issue, I didn't want to play up the density issue in COVID-19, but clearly it's a significant issue of infection. The higher the density, the greater the chance of infection. But I actually think at the moment, when we're designing new communities, we have to use the principles of regenerative design and try and create them in a less dense manner. For existing communities, well, you know, I grew up in Toronto, and Toronto was always considered to be a city of neighborhoods, of very low-rise buildings. And now there is a move to knock down those neighborhoods and build more and more dense kinds of housing. What I've seen in Toronto, and particularly down in the Toronto waterfront, is a real disaster in terms of architecture and urban planning, where it's simply become way too dense. So we've got to start considering density when we think about cities. And now is a perfect time to do it, because we absolutely have to think about the future of cities in the face of COVID-19. And we have to, so many companies are going, well, and the RAIC, the Royal Architectural Institute of Canada, is one. They go, well, you know, we're all working from home now. Do we really need to pay for this expensive office in downtown Ottawa? And they've concluded no. Even after COVID-19 is gone, they're going to close their physical offices and have everybody working virtually. Of course, Athabasca, Henry and Veronica and Trevor and I have been doing that for years. And frankly, there's so many benefits to it. For example, my commute consists of me going from my coffee maker across my kitchen and into my office. And that saves a lot of carbon in terms of driving and other things like that. So I know I'm not answering your question directly, but we need to, when we build new communities, we have to make sure that they're the proper density. And when we're renovating and looking at old communities, we have to make sure that we're not densifying them to the point of making them unlivable. And I didn't go into half the studies that I looked at for densities, and every one of them showed the negative effects of higher density, from learning abilities to community spirit to even, you know, I mean, you can imagine doing this experiment. You take children and you keep pushing more and more children into the room until they start fighting. That's one experiment somebody did, and it was actually kind of horrifying that they would do that. But this is what happens. And here in Kelowna, for example, they've now permit what are called micro suites, which are 300 square feet in area. And you go, what are the effects going to be on people in those environments as time progresses? And that's kind of the worst part about it is, I looked at the rents for those micro suites compared to a 1,000 square foot loft, and found that they were actually charging these people in those micro suites more per square foot than if you had been renting an 1,000 square foot loft. So what worries me most is how greed is driving so much of our economy and of our architecture.
Well, there's an interesting follow-up question here from Darcy, saying that existing communities that function with municipalities as a proto-cooperative are typically marked for gentrification. There is a common theme of being priced out of your home, and community co-op ties loosen over time and the self-sufficiency of a community dissolving. Can you address this with the idea of simply separating ourselves from the systems we cannot change?
Well, in fact, I think, if I understand correctly, the Preston and Cleveland model really address that situation. So here we have an existing community, but what they do is get the anchor institutions to commit to using local suppliers and local materials. So what that does is, if you have that commitment, then it keeps jobs in the community. And by keeping jobs in the community, it keeps income in the community. And that way, I'm not saying everybody becomes gentrified together, but income and having meaningful work is absolutely critical to us moving forward together in a better manner. And so that's why I think that income generation, what Mondragon was doing, what I'm trying to suggest here could happen in Hope, all of these things are critically important. There has to be some way of making jobs for people, but the entities that control those jobs have to be co-ops rather than corporations, because then you do get exactly the situation where gentrification, if a co-op becomes valuable, then people want to be part of it, they buy into it, it becomes gentrified, it becomes sold off. And co-ops are, you know, they're fragile. Mountain Equipment Co-op, which was one of the big ones in North America, just basically went under recently because of the stress and strain in COVID. So there is issues, but there are, I believe, solutions, particularly in the Cleveland and Preston model, even for existing communities.
Great. We have a question from Alana. She says that, I'm a sociology student and interested in alternatives to capitalism. I'm curious, you have mentioned capitalism and profit. I often wonder why the focus on profit. Are you saying that because we can't change the economy and political system, you suggest working within or alongside of?
Yeah, I should be upfront. I do believe we can change the system. And I actually believe that it starts with exactly kind of building scenarios for a better future, as I've tried to do here. I think it was like Oscar Wilde once said that London didn't have any fog until Whistler started painting it. In other words, until we're aware of the problem, we don't see it. We don't see the future until somebody describes it to us. And so that's why science fiction prototyping is so incredibly important. We have to, I'm going to be the first one to admit that there's all sorts of flaws in the argument of the architecture of hope, but it suggests that we need to do more work in developing better scenarios for how we could work together. And those scenarios can be incredibly powerful. Now, for example, in basically The entire space program, whatever you think of it, came out of the science fiction of the 20s and 30s when people were imagining rockets to the moon. And then all of a sudden they were building it. I saw the same thing in terms of virtual reality and cyberspace. William Gibson writes this novel Neuromancer, and then all of a sudden, these all these companies who are actually trying to build it. So science fiction prototyping is something I highly recommend, being able to describe a better future. And in the act of describing it, you actually have to deal with all of the issues and figure out how things work. And that creates precedents that you people can then try to build. So I'm not saying, absolutely not arguing for armed revolution, but creating examples and precedents for change is the best way we can do things. And also being vocal. Lobbying groups are way too powerful, particularly in the United States and Canada. We are faced with a serious disadvantage. If we had a people's lobbying group who could actually argue for policies which are good for us rather than bad for us, it would be a really effective thing. And I know there are some public policy institutes, but sadly they are not nearly as well founded as some of the corporate ones. And that's distressing. Lobbying groups distress me greatly, of course, and they're one of the major things standing in the way of us doing things effectively. But even sharing information. I mean, I was actually quite surprised to find out how much tax rates had fallen for the top 1%, how much corporate tax rates had fallen over the course of a few years. We don't often hear about that, and we need to share that information because it's absolutely critical to understanding the situation that we're in and perhaps even changing it.
Great. So the next question is, we know that industries of finance and insurance have an outsized influence of how and what things get built. How can we engage these conservative institutions in these newer models of practice?
Yes, and that's really important. I use the example of the CMHC deliberately because the CMHC has changed over time. They used to, for example, in fact, Terry Montgomery and some of my other colleagues are online. Way back in 79, we all worked on competitions for new kinds of housing for the CMHC. More recently, they had competitions to do what are called equilibrium houses, which are designed to be net zero carbon houses. They used to be actively involved in the research component of housing. They, in fact, a number of us benefited from their largesse to do green building exchanges with China and South Korea. Then all of a sudden, it was realized that the CMHC was a cash cow and all of those things stopped. In fact, there was a while when they were even getting out of the building of houses. I'm very pleased to report that that's changing now, that there's now getting more interest in research into housing. More houses are being built, but I think we could do more and we could use the resources that we have more. And I don't want to pick on Alberta, but the government of Alberta a few months ago announced that they were going to put $1.1 billion into the Keystone Pipeline. Now, if Joe Biden is elected in a week or two, and let's hope to God he is, he's going to cancel the Keystone Pipeline. And think how many houses you could build for $1.1 billion. Now, if we were doing those Russian ones, we could build 100,000 houses, basically. Perhaps not that many, but a heck of a, you know, $10,000 houses it's quite extraordinary. I don't think you can really do it for that amount, but it's really about putting our money in better places, in investing our money. And let's face it, taxes are our money. We should be able to vocalize if they're not being spent properly. So $1.5 billion, the profit the CMHC was putting back into the general coffers, that's a great place to start. And it is true, you know, you have to have some money in order to do some things, but that's one where our taxes could be used better. And I think every government around the world needs to think seriously about the housing problem, but also housing by itself won't do it because we need to think about the income problem and how do we actually create meaningful jobs in our communities. And that's why I think that the unit that we have to be looking at is not the individual building, but the community itself, because only by having all of the elements of the community working together in a mesh network can we actually start to make a viable community. And a viable community, I also would include almost generating enough income for everybody in the community to have a meaningful job.
So the next question comes from Viv. States and asks, I now feel some hope for the future. Thank you. The only lingering question I have on my mind is about convincing those who are either unaware or on the fence when it comes to such brilliantly grounded architectural ideas. While the various components, each in itself proves to be beneficial, don't we want to set up a model living environment that fully integrates the components to evaluate its holistic unity, utility? Have there been studies and results that have that are convincing about holistic design?
Yes, I think that those are, thank you for your kind remarks, Viv. And I think you're absolutely right. We need to, all of us, figure out how to build some of these things. We, the Kapute Newtown, for example, is trying to be energy self-sufficient as well. So there's actually some models being built that we could learn from. And it does seem to me, though, that the time has come for us to create a model community. Now, even we could just do it virtually at the moment. The next step would be to make it sort of a functional community in a virtual space to start to simulate how it would work. I mean, that would cost a lot less than building it totally. I think that would be actually a wonderful project that we could all work on, perhaps even in the global studio, and then figuring out what are the common principles, what works, what doesn't work, what works in one environment might not work in another environment, but the only way that we're ever going to figure that out is to actually test it. And so with some of these ideas, you know, the challenge will be, yes, we might be able to get money to do one of those deep geothermal loops. We might get money to 3D print houses. But yes, you're right. We would need a significant amount of money to do all of it together. But what an interesting, you know, they used to always talk, we kind of lost our faith in the future. And we used to always have things like at exhibitions, there used to be the home of the future. And it seems to me we need to return to that kind of, and I know I'm talking kind of utopian things. And we found out in the 60s and 70s that utopias don't actually work all that well ever. But we kind of backtracked so far as to suggest, well, there's nothing we can do about anything, so let's just do things stylistically and make them very attractive. That's not good enough either. I think we have to return to some of the spirit that we had in the 60s and 70s, saying we can change the world, and we have to change the world because it's falling to pieces if we don't. So while it will be difficult, the beauty of the Global Studio is that it is like a mesh network. It's like we are kind of like our own global fungus. You can quote me on that. The idea that we're all connected and that what we might be able to share, or what Lesotho might be able to share with us, and what Monterey Tech might be able to share with us, and what Cardiff Wales might be able to share with us, and once we have lots of good affiliates in Australia and South Africa, we need to start sharing more. And if somebody said, well, we want to build a model community in Nigeria, wouldn't we all want to work on that? And if we did, then, you know, the more commitment we have, yes, we didn't get the first amount of money that we asked for, but that's not unusual. We will keep asking for money so we can keep doing these activities and making them bigger and bigger and bigger. So I'm hoping that everybody who's online will stay with us and keep working together and even suggest ideas or look for resources that we could all share. Because I really do think we only scratch the surface of what we could do in terms of particularly the global education. In fact, the next book I'm working on is called The Architecture of Learning, in which it describes a global learning system, which frankly could be superb, but also be free for everybody to get an undergraduate education. And that would change the world. Again, it would cost money. I'll stop there on that one. But everybody on this call has so much to contribute and share. And if we work together, we literally could change the world.
The next question is from Laura, who's actually one of our architecture students. And I want to also mention a finalist at the Timber Fever competition that just completed. So she writes, this presentation and book illustrates to me how architecture can model a better world, one that we desperately need. How do we bring this into life? You mentioned the possibility of a student-led global studio. Is an interdisciplinary international project of hope in the works?
I would like to think so. We haven't quite fleshed it out yet, but it would be a wonderful activity. So, and let me just tell you a little bit more about the global studio and what we hope to do, despite, you know, we didn't get the funding we wanted. One thing I do want to share with you, David Covo, who used to be the director of the School of Architecture at McGill, volunteered his time to run his sketching camp online for all of us. And we need the participation and the help from some of the different schools, but that alone would be a wonderful activity. And the other thing, though, that we want to try and get some money to do, and there's already a project in Canada called Students as Partners. We would like to get students working together to create new curriculum materials. Those materials would be open educational resources. They would look at everything from different kinds of perspectives, different cultural perspectives, different gender perspectives. So we would be able to, a lot of our textbooks, sadly, and a lot of our curriculum, not just at Athabasca, but everywhere around the world, it needs to have a kind of a fresh start in terms of diversity, equity, and inclusion. And that's really important. So imagine, and I think I can get money for this, we get some money for students to work together to build the new materials that we would share with everyone. And so we would still have courses and we would still charge tuition for them, but it could be modular, so we could take this animation or that little piece of interactivity or that film or this picture and have everybody agree that you could incorporate them into your learning materials at no cost. And that's, I think, Laura, the first start. The first thing that we could do is if we change the way we educate architects, then that's not a bad way to change the way we build the world. And congratulations on the Timber Fever.
So we have quite a few comments, which I'm going to leave for everyone to read in the chat box. And I'm just going to skip down to some questions. There was a question sent to me from Kevin asking about the mentorship program. So I just want to mention, if anyone is interested in participating, please just send me an email and I will put my email address in the chat box towards the end of the lecture. There's another question from Kevin Matthews asking, so what happens to all of those vacant downtown offices?
Well, isn't that an interesting project for somebody to work on? I mean, what a great student project, right? Take an existing office tower and convert it into a cooperative live workspace. I mean, I think it'd be a great thing to look at. And could you make it energy self-sufficient? Could you make it income self-sufficient? Could you run it as a cooperative? It's a wonderful thing. In fact, yeah, I can see somebody really jumping on that one. That's kind of exciting.
This next question comes from Ken Lever from South Africa, I believe. So he writes, I'm struggling to equate your unified network approach to our unbalanced and desperate communities in Southern Africa, where we have a mishmash of first world and third world communities. To think more deeply about our problems in an appropriate approach, how do I get a copy of your textbook?
Oh, okay. First of all, you should see on your screen, if you go to Woodlake Books, you can actually, you can buy the book in either hard copy or as an e-text. So it's very, frankly, I wish I could give it away, but I actually want to support the small publishers as well. It is very inexpensive. So South Africa is, of course, it's a very interesting test case, isn't it? I was in South Africa about 15 years ago in Johannesburg, and it is quite remarkable. There's, for example, I was taken to a place called Monte Cassino, which is a hermetically sealed shopping mall, even to the extent that they've got an artificial sky painted on the ceiling. And when you pull your car into the gated parking lot, the first place you go is to leave your weapons in the gun room. And so, and as you drive to this place, of course, though, you are seeing in fact, the very kinds of environment that Kristen and her team will be talking about in a couple of weeks in terms of the environment. And it is really interesting, but the hope here is that the Kapute New Town represents a totally different approach where you could be building what, you know, you're absolutely right. We have first world, we have the third world, but we need something kind of in between that is more reflective, which is a better environment, a safer environment than we're seeing quite frankly now, where, but also, you know, it's also about equity. And how do we start getting people into kind of work that's meaningful and that generates enough income for them to thrive? And that's why we need to look at examples all around the world. And the thing that I didn't share about Caputo Newtown is that many people operate businesses right out of their houses. And how could the community be generating all of the things that the community needs and therefore keeping all of the income and the jobs in the community? And that's why the principles that I wanted to add to Mondragon's 10 principles of how to run a cooperative is to make it decentralized and localized. And so at a certain point, I mean, this is utopian thinking, I do apologize for this, but if you think about it, if you live in a community where all of your needs are satisfied and you're healthy and you're safe and your well-being is assured, do you care about being rich? And it's a very interesting, what point do we go, okay, maybe I've got everything I need. In fact, I must admit, I know I've lived a very, 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 very privileged life. But as I get older, I kind of think, well, I don't need a fancy car. I don't want a fancy car. I don't want a huge mansion. What I really like is being able to sit on my back porch and watch the deer walk across the yard. And sometimes where I live, and I'm not trying to make people feel bad, but sometimes where I live, it is so quiet. If you're sitting out on an evening, you can actually hear the deer chewing on the branches. It's so nice and quiet. So all I'm saying is that we should all have this. We should all have this, and we should all have meaningful work. And I think we can do it if we relocalize and decentralize. And if we work in a cooperative fashion, and we have the examples of Mondragon, our challenge is, as I think Viv mentioned, is knitting all of these things together into a coherent and comprehensive whole. And that's what I'm trying to do by writing these scenarios, but it's really a challenge to us all to be more active in how we change the world, because we need to.
So Douglas, we're coming up to the end of the session. Should we get one more question?
Yeah, I don't mind. I realize people have to go, and nobody has to stay till the bitter end. But I'm happy to, if Veronica, if you're okay, I'm happy to keep answering questions as long as they have some.
Okay, we'll do. So the next question is, interesting you mentioned the urban planning disaster of downtown Toronto. The Future City seminar a couple of days ago mentioned how everyone has left their shoebox condos because we cannot live in a box 24/7. The condos only work when the inhabitants spend more, some or most of their time at the office, at the bar, at the gym, at the theater, anywhere but home. Your presentation is super aspirational discussion. How do we ensure this gets mainstream traction?
Well, that's very kind of you. This, for me, this is kind of mainstream traction. And I do want to talk a bit about Toronto, because I grew up there and I love that city. In fact, when I went to university, man, it was so incredible. You could wander downtown Toronto any time of the day or night. We pretty much knew every alleyway. I shouldn't tell you this, but we knew every speakeasy, every club. It was an incredibly rich environment. And there was always affordable rental places, you know, many of them old houses, and we would get in there and we would paint and sand floors, and it was a wonderful thing. But each time that I go back to Toronto, it gets denser and denser. The traffic problems, of course, become worse and worse. And I was, a couple of years ago, I wanted to go and see the new addition to Fort York and what they had done there, beautiful building. But it was a rainy day, so I was walking underneath the Gardiner Expressway, and I was looking at on the waterfront where they built all of these condos. And I looked up and I saw that one condo was low enough that its view was actually of the underside of the Gardiner Expressway. And I thought, what planner in their right mind, what architect in their right mind would think this was okay? And we really need to think carefully about future developments and what we do with them. And I think Toronto still has huge opportunities if we don't destroy the neighborhoods. And some people really would like to see those neighborhoods gone so that they could build more condo towers. And maybe, as you say, condo towers would work if you have lots of amenities around you. But isn't it a shame that we're building spaces for people to live where it's premised on the fact that they stay there as little as possible? I find that incredibly depressing, actually. So we need to think differently about that. And again, remember, we were talking about this in one of our design studios the other night, is one of the key things that's driving architecture today is real estate. And we have to understand real estate. And real estate basically, you know, is predicated on the fact that the price of real estate has to keep going up. Well, it won't. We will soon, and Toronto and Vancouver are perfect examples of this. Soon, even though it hasn't happened yet, we may see that the boom market goes bust, and then, wow, that's going to be pretty incredible. So we almost need to be smarter. We're architects, I've learned, are not very good business people. So how do we change that? Well, it starts with our curriculum. We need to I don't want people to become greedy, but we need to understand how money works, and we don't, frankly, we don't. So that's a first step.
So the next comes from Trevor Jacobs. It's a more of a comment than a question, but he writes, Rain Eisler speaks about an economy of well-being instead of one based on GDP. If such a development is self-sufficient, perhaps it can shift towards health and well-being.
Yes. The GDP, the gross domestic product, is the measure of our economies. And of course, it's such a bizarre measure when you dig into it, because natural disasters that cost us billions of dollars to clean up add to the GDP. Cancer rates, which cause cancer, which triggers expensive treatments, adds to the GDP. So you're right. We are not measuring the right things, and that's part of the problem. In fact, there's a number of instances of people looking at for the happiness index, which I find much more interesting than the GDP. But until we move away from the GDP and evaluating the worth of a country in terms of just strictly market exchange, then we do have a problem. And that's like indicative of why we have a problem in terms of solving climate change. That GDP is driving our actions, and we need better measures. So you're absolutely right.
The next question is just asking about if this presentation is being recorded. And so, yes, we are recording it. And we will post this presentation along with all of our other Global Studio lectures on our website, which we will send a link to once it is up on our website.
And I just wanted to thank everybody, because our YouTube channel is getting lots and lots of hits. There's various lectures have now got several hundred viewers, and that's wonderful. And again, we really appreciate the fact that all of these speakers have kindly allowed us to present it so that anybody can see their lecture, their video for free.
The next question comes from Yuri, who I just want to say hello to. He was a professor of mine when I went to Ryerson many years ago. So he's asking, economist Kate Raworth has developed an alternative economic model, donut economics, which considers environmental ceilings and social foundations. Any potential here?
Absolutely. I mean, we need to engage the economists to give us new systems for how we could do things. And I'll probably be looking that one up to learn more about it.
Okay. So I'm just scrolling through. There's lots of comments, Douglas, which I'll give you a transcript of.
Well, thank you.
Okay, so let's go to Lee. Lee is asking, in an overpopulated world where sustainability really means working within the limited resources the Earth can regenerate, I believe that regeneration is key in an architecture of hope. I feel that we don't need models for new communities, but models of how regenerate and reform existing ones. How do we apply the architecture of hope principles to our existing building stock and existing communities, repurpose buildings to work for us?
Yeah, that's a very, very good question, but there, I just want to unpack it just a little bit. We do the population of the world is growing. There's absolutely no doubt about that. But some studies I've read are suggesting that it's going to stabilize just with the way that growth rates are kind of slowing in some countries. Of course, they're accelerating in others, but not as fast a rate. We may find that we stabilize our population soon. And that that could be very useful for the world in general. But one of the things I found, and again, I didn't talk about this because even I find this a little bit incredulous, that according to one chart that I saw, and it actually is referenced in the book, human beings occupy only 1% of the inhabitable land on the planet. Now, we like to congregate in cities because of the economic opportunities. But if, and of course, this is a relatively recent development where previously most people, right up into the 20th century, most people lived in rural environments. And of course, with the change in the way that work and industrialization, there was a mass migration to cities. So if COVID-19 is showing us that maybe we don't need to work right in the cities all the time, if there really is much more inhabitable land, and you know, from my experience, and I sadly used to travel a lot, which is not a very environmentally sensitive thing to do, but as I fly across Canada, the United States, and even flying across Africa and other places, yes, there are some huge cities that seem to go on forever. Los Angeles is one of the worst. But in between, there's massive amounts of space. Not all of it is inhabitable, but there's still massive amounts of space. So are we misleading ourselves about the fact that we have to live so closely in cities? And but to answer the second part of the question, I do think, you know, looking at how we revitalize existing buildings and maybe even changing their use. In the 70s, you know, we were looking at a lot of interesting reuse opportunities. And Toronto, again, is an interesting example. There were all these warehouses built with basically heavy timber construction as their structure, holding them up, and then wrapped in a masonry facade. These are wonderful buildings for converting into just about anything, and they have been. These are the kinds of things that we might think about, how we can rework our communities to be places to work and to live in a healthy and safe environment with meaningful opportunities. And so that's what I think we could be doing. And there's great projects, as I say, in looking at how all of these things could work together. Even the suburbs. What happens? What would happen if a suburb became a place to work? What if it was, if everybody in the suburb was now working from their home? What changes would you make to the suburb in order to do things differently? Even to the extent of the roadways, because if we move towards a system where we're using autonomous vehicles, or we're using electric vehicles, or we're using drones for all sorts of things, our road system becomes a very different proposition. And so what would we want to do to the suburbs to change them into a work-life environment? It's again, I think there's tremendous opportunities for us as both architects and students to start to investigate those possibilities in the design studios that we do.
Great. So I think we're coming to our last question. There's lots of comments, but there's a question here. With the increasing specialization in our profession, how can we reopen ourselves to learn and to learning and working in a general way?
Yeah, well, yeah, and I would say that's what we're doing here in the Global Studio. I mean, it is so, to tell you the truth, I have so enjoyed hearing all of the different perspectives that have been shared, from Dr. Mappe's work on sketching scary places, the work that Medili was showing us about African architecture. All, again and again, we're seeing that there's wonderful things going on all around the world. We just simply need to share more. I mean, these are, if you're a licensed professional, you can get continuing education credits for this. And if you know of somebody who should be a speaker, or if you think that you've got something you would like to share, this is the way we do it. Yes, we do become very specialized, but there's always forums, and let's hope we continue these forums, where we can share at exactly this level, where it's about exchanging ideas and learning from what other people are doing. So by all means, let's continue this as a venue for doing exactly what you were suggesting.
Great. So Douglas, I think that we came across our last question. As I mentioned, there's lots of wonderful comments here. If there's any other questions, if there isn't any, perhaps we should conclude.
All right. Just a final thank you to you, Veronica, and to Henry, and to Carol, and to Lara for all their incredible hard work. And thank you to everybody for showing up today. The snow is really coming down. I can't believe that it's starting to cover everything here. So it's kind of a very interesting day, but it speaks to the fact that we can connect all over the globe and share these kinds of ideas. And also a thank you to Woodlake for helping me publish this. And with that, shall we wrap her up?
Great, yes.
And don't forget to join us on November 3rd for the movie.
Thanks, Douglas. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Take care, everybody.